الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلي وأسلم على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، نبينا وحبيبنا وقرة أعيننا محمد بن عبد الله، عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. وقال تعالى في كتابه العزيز بعد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الله نور السماوات والأرض، مثل نوره كمشكاة فيها مصباح، المصباح في زجاجة، الزجاجة كأنها كوكب دري يوقد من شجرة مباركة زيتونة لا شرقية ولا غربية، يكاد زيتها يضيء ولو لم تمسسه نار، نور على نور، يهدي الله لنوره من يشاء، ويضرب الله الأمثال للناس، والله بكل شيء عليم. صدق الله العظيم. All praise and thanks be to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher, and protector and curer. May the choicest of his blessings and salutations be upon our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family members, his companions, and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, it is incumbent upon us to praise Allah and thank Him for blessing us once again with an opportunity to meet and continue this beautiful journey of ours with the blessed name of Allah. In the last session we discussed about the Lafzul Jalala, the greatest word ever, and that is Allah. We discussed about the name Allah, there is a little more to cover on it, and then we also discussed about the word, the name Rabb, which is also attributed or linked to the name Allah. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, before we continue with the name Allah, there are two things that I wish to clarify. And that is in regard to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being our creator. In regard to the ayat that talk about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that describe Allah the Almighty, just as we discussed in the previous session, that it is Allah the Almighty who has the best capability to describe Himself. It is Allah who can do it. So that's the reason we refer to the Quran ayat in regard to the description of Allah, in regard to who Allah is. For our minds are futile, our minds are weak. We cannot try to perceive the greatness of Allah the Almighty. Nor can even the most eloquent of scholars ever try to describe the greatness of Allah the Almighty and encompass the whole thing. It is impossible. So in regard to our logic, in regard to our reasoning, otherwise known as the aql, we have something called the aql and then naql. Aql is our logic, our reasoning, our thinking. And in regard to the naql, that is the Quran and the Sunnah. Quran and the Sunnah. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, now in regard to the Quran and the Sunnah, all of us know what is the Quran. All of us know what is the Quran. So what about Sunnah? When I say Sunnah, am I talking about miswak? Am I talking about the beard? Am I talking about the turban? My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, when the scholars of Islam, when they say Sunnah, it means the aqwal of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, af'al of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the iqrar of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and finally one more category which many people are not aware of, the Sunnah al-Tarkiyah. Four categories of Sunnah. Primarily what Sunnah means is the sayings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the aqwal of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the primary category. And that is how we have the books of ahadith, the books that have recorded all of the ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, no other religion has it. No other religion has the sayings of their leaders or their prophets recorded the way the sayings of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has been recorded. And for that Allah the Almighty, He made use of great scholars, giants such as Al-Imam Al-Bukhari rahimahullah, Al-Imam Muslim rahimahullah, Imam Abu Dawud rahimahullah, Imam Nasa'i rahimahullah, Imam Ibn Majah rahimahullah. All of these giants, Imam Ibn Hajar Al-Asqalani rahimahullah, so many names, so many giants, Allah the Almighty used them to protect the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Up till date, scholars today, even now, they can give you the chain, the link, until Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from so and so, from so and so, from so and so, until Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No other religion, no one else can say we have a statement as such and we have the narrations, we have the chain until our leader or until our prophet. And that is the reason why there are so many distortions, so many fabrications in their narrations. But on the other hand, in regard to the sayings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, yes, people tried to fabricate, people tried to distort the sayings, but then came the scholars, they asked you, from where did you get the hadith that you're quoting? Give us your narrators. The minute they started stumbling with the narrators, they knew that the hadith is fabricated. Or else, even if they gave them a fabricated chain, they would know. The science of hadith, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, it is a great science. It is a science, asma'ul rijal, al-jarh wa al-ta'dil. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, al-imam Bukhari rahimahullah, when you say he's a hafiz, not hafiz al-Quran, hafiz al-hadith, he has not only memorized the text of the hadith. You say, innama al-a'malu bin-niyyat, this is the text of the hadith. He has not only memorized the text, but rather he has memorized the chain too. From whom, whose teacher, from the student to the teacher, and from that teacher to the shaykh, and so on until the tabi'i, and then next go on to sahabi, and then to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And not only the chain, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, he knows their biographies too. He knows their biographies too. The science of hadith, the scholars of hadith were so strict in accepting a hadith from an individual, that you have in the books of the science of hadith that so and so, say for example you have the person named Muhammad ibn Abdullah for example. Okay, say Abdul Rahman ibn Abdullah for example. Abdul Rahman ibn Abdullah, the scholars used to check, was he pious? Has he lied in any instance? Has he cheated anybody? Has he deceived anybody? For if he had, they would not accept hadith from him. What they would say is, if he can deceive someone else, if he can lie, there is a possibility that he could lie in regard to the narrations of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Once there was a person, you see today, at the click of a button, with the sending of a message, you can get the message across the world, around the globe. But in those days, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, even if you were to collect a hadith, one narration, you'd pack your bags, bid your family farewell, there's a possibility that you may not come back, get on your camel and start traversing. You come to the ocean, you need to take a ship and travel. Months and months and months they used to travel just to get one hadith. Today, alhamdulillah, due to the work of all of these great scholars, we have all of it compiled within our hands. And now we have it in a program too. One program. You want to search about riba, you just type in the word riba, it gives you all the ahadith from all the books. You don't have to go into the library and start taking out volume after volume, going through the contents and searching for the word. Allah has made it so simple for us today. And today we say, having it all so simple, we say, oh, this scholar, his statement is weak, and this person's statement is weak. What right do we have? What right do we have to put down the scholars as such? Today the scholars are scholars on the internet, scholars of Wikipedia, scholars of Google. They are the ones who try to put down the other scholars. Each scholar has to be respected, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, for the great service that they did to this deen of Allah. Then he protected the ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So coming back to that story, they have to travel months and months. So there was this one scholar who traveled for months just to get one narration. Now after this tiring journey, you see, no worldly gain. He's not going to close $1 million deal and then collect the hadith and come. No. One hadith, is just traveling for that, for no other reason. So he reaches that particular vicinity or the particular area where that person is living, and as he gets close to that person's house, he sees that person doing something with the hens that he has. You know, hens, chickens, he's got some hens. And he sees that he is fooling the hens by showing something like this, as if he's trying to fool the hen, thinking there is food in the bucket and making the hen come close by. And as the hen comes close by, he pushes the hen into the cage and locks the cage. So he's deceiving the animal. He's cheating the animal. It's, many people do. You tell your child, come here, come here, I'll give you a toffee, and then you don't give it. This is something normal. But this scholar, he noted this, he turned back and went back. He turned back and went back. He went back home. It was asked why. He said, if this man can deceive an animal, what guarantee do I have that he may not deceive me in regard to the narration of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam? Allahu Akbar. This is how strict they were in filtering and collecting the ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And this is how, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam was protected. But then the famous hadith of Ma'di Karib radiyallahu anhu, he says that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, Ala inni utitul Qur'ana wa mislah. Okay? The Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that indeed I have been given the Quran and something similar to that. And what is that? Rasulullah is talking about his sunnah, about the tradition of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And then the hadith goes on along these lines. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam then says, but then there will come a nation, there will come a group who would suffice themselves with only the Quran. They would say that the Quran is enough for us. We don't need the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. It could be fabricated. It may be not authentic. So we don't want the hadith. The Quran is sufficient for us. They would make halal what the Quran has only made halal, and haram what the Quran has only made haram. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, know one thing, that the Quran and the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam go hand in hand. They go hand in hand. They go hand in hand. The sunnah of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam explains the Quran. I ask these people who suffice themselves with the Quran, tell them to bring one verse of the Quran, one evidence from the Quran that Isha salah is 4 rakat, one verse from the Quran. Dhuhr salah is 4 rakat, one verse from the Quran. They would never be able to. The reason being, it is the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Please remember salawat whenever I mention his name. It is his sunnah that comes in and explains that which is concise in the Quran, that which is mujmal in the Quran. As-sunnah tubayyinul mujmal. The sunnah comes in and it explains what is concise in the Quran, what is summarized in the Quran. As-sunnah tuqayyidul mutlaq. As-sunnah tukhassisul aam. The sunnah is that which comes in and specifies the general. For example, look at the Quran ayah. وَالسَّارِقُ وَالسَّارِقَةُ فَقُطَعُوا أَيْدِيَهُمَا جَزَاءً بِمَا كَسَبَا نَكَالًا مِّنَ اللَّهِ. The thief, whether he be male or female, chop his hand off. The Quran ayah. فَقُطَعُوا أَيْدِيَهُمَا. So now from where do you chop his hand off? So if I ask you, brother, from where you chop it, okay, we'll chop it off from here. Okay, you, what about you? Okay, from here, and then from here. Each one will have his own interpretation. As-sunnah tuqayyidul mutlaq. It is a general statement in the Quran. Chop off their hands. But now from where do you chop? How do you cut their hands off? And are there instances where it could be excused? All of this, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, Sunnah comes in and explains. Sunnah comes in and explains. Without the Sunnah, you would be lost. You would be lost in explaining this ayah. As-Sunnah tubayyinu al-mujmal, As-Sunnah tukhassisu al-aam, for example. Look at the ayah. حرمت عليكم الميتة والدم ولحم الخنزير. The ayah goes on. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O believers, it is haram upon you all. Al-mayta. All dead animals are haram upon you. All dead animals are haram upon you. Al-dam. All types of blood is haram upon you. Then what about fish? What about the delicacies of the sea? What about fish? Fish is a dead animal. So now, what do you catch the fish and start making qurban of it? You're going to slaughter the fish? What about liver? Liver is a part of the body which consists of 90 to 95% blood. What about the spleen? You have these delicacies which you all eat, liver and spleen. What about them? Then the Quran ayah is saying it's all haram. The hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes in. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, it is a riwayah in Ahmad, recorded in Ahmad. Uhilla lana maytatan wa daman. Two dead animals have been made halal upon us. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying. What are these two animals? A samak, fish, all types of fish are halal for you. As you catch it out from the sea, whether it be dead, no problem, you can eat it. You can eat it. Wal jarad. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, locusts. We of the Asian region, we would not know what it is. Locusts are like grasshoppers. Like grasshoppers. They do not have flowing blood. And there is a season when they swarm around the Kaaba. And the Arabs have the habit of collecting these locusts. Like grasshoppers. They dry it in the sun and they eat it. It is a delicacy according to them. Locusts. We could also try it. Locust, so it is halal. Yeah, you can try it, it is halal. May be like some kind of a mixture or something like that, you know. You dry it in the sun, maybe like Pringles perhaps. So locust, halal, you can have it. Okay? And then wal kabid wat tihal. The liver and the spleen. Liver and the spleen. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying the hadith, daman, two types of blood have been made halal. Kabid. But tihal, you can have your green peas curry with the liver pieces in it. It's halal. And tihal, spleen is also halal. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, it is the hadith. It is the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that comes in. This is just one example. This is just one example. There are many examples where you need the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to explain the Quran. To explain the Quran. To explain what is concise in it. What is summarized in it. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, this is the topic, this is the point that I wanted to touch in regard to aql and naql. In regard to your aql, it is necessary. We don't shun it. You need it. You need logic. You need reasoning. But in the same way, you need the naql. That is the text. The Quran and the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And remember, the complete deen is not based on your logic and on your reasoning. If it would have been as such, then the deen would have become like a toy. It would have become like a toy. Each person would mold it the way his fancies and his desires went. Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, he was commanded by Allah the Almighty, slaughter your son. Does that sound logical to you? Is there any benefit in that? Slaughtering your son? But did he ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in return, Ya Allah, that doesn't sound so logical. So I don't feel like doing it. No, Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam immediately complied to the order of Allah the Almighty. So remember, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, everything in the deen of Allah the Almighty does not go according to your logic and according to your reasoning. So now in regard to Allah, the best way to understand our beloved maker, the best way to understand our beloved creator, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, is to look around at the creation. Look around at the creation of Allah the Almighty. رَبَّنَا رَبَّنَا مَا خَلَقْتَ هَذَا بَاطِلًا سُبْحَانَكَ سُبْحَانَكَ فَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ.
Oh our Lord, Rabbana, ma khalaqta hadha batila.
There is not a single atom, not a single molecule in this universe that you have created in vain. There is nothing. You have created every single thing with a purpose.
Subhanak, glory be to you, Ya Allah, the owner of the throne.
Faqina azab an-nar. Save us from the torment of the fire. Save us from the torment of Jahannam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect all of us from the fire of Jahannam. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, the best way to understand Allah is to look at His creation. For example, look around you. Look around you. Look at the mountains. Allah the Almighty, He is the one who knows the actual weight of the mountain. He is the one who knows the actual weight of one mountain. He is the one who knows how many drops of water are there in the ocean. He is the one who knows how many grains of sand are there in the complete earth. He is the one who knows the amount of leaves on the tree. It is Allah, Allah, Allah. It is only Allah. It is only Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
الَّذِي خَلَقَ سَبْعَ سَمَاوَاتٍ طِبَاقًا الَّذِي خَلَقَ سَبْعَ سَمَاوَاتٍ طِبَاقًا مَا تَرَى فِي خَلْقِ الرَّحْمَنِ مِنْ تَفَاوُتٍ
الَّذِي خَلَقَ سَبْعَ سَمَاوَاتٍ طِبَاقًا It is Allah who created the seven heavens in layers, one after the other.
ما ترى في خلق الرحمن من تفاوت
ما ترى You will never ever see in the creation of the Rahman, in the creation of our beloved Maker, an inconsistency. You will never see it.
فارجع البصر هل ترى من فطور
Look towards the sky. Look towards the sky. Do you see any break within it? Some people ask, where are the seven layers of the seven heavens? My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, no one has even encompassed the first heaven to talk about the remaining six heavens. No one. No one. There's still conspiracies going on, rumors going on, whether they actually landed on the moon or not. Who are we to believe? CNN? BBC? Who are we to believe?
This is the great creation of Allah the Almighty.
So if you have not even encompassed one heaven, how dare you talk about the remaining six heavens? How dare you talk about it?
So, فَرْجِعِ الْبَصَرَ هَذْرَى مِنْ فُطُورِ
Do you see a break within the heavens?
ثُمَّ ارْجِعِ الْبَصَرَ كَرَّتَيْنِ
You looked once, now look again, look again.
ثُمَّ ارْجِعِ الْبَصَرَ كَرَّتَيْنِ Look again. يَنْقَلِبْ إِلَيْكَ الْبَصَرُ خَاسِئًا وَهُوَ حَسِيرٌ
Look again and you look however many times you want.
يَنْقَلِبْ إِلَيْكَ الْبَصَرُ خَاسِئًا وَهُوَ حَسِيرٌ
Your eyesight will come back to you, what? Dismayed, tired, fatigued. You will never ever find a flaw in the creation of Allah the Almighty. You will never find an inconsistency. You will never ever find a break in His creation, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. Allah goes on,
وَلَقَدْ زَيَّنَّا السَّمَاءَ الدُّنْيَا بِمَصَابِيحِ
And Allah the Almighty, He is the one who has decorated the skies, beautified the skies with lamps, which are the stars.
وَجَعَلْنَاهَا رُجُومًا لِلشَّيَاطِينِ
And He made them رُجُومًا لِلشَّيَاطِينِ Objects that are thrown and hurled at the shayateen. You have shooting stars. You have shooting stars. The reason being, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, you see, an individual going to a fortune teller. You know fortune teller? Soothsayer, the one who says your future will be like this and like that. You don't necessarily have to go to an expert. There are some people who just look at your face and say, I think your future will be like this. Or you're going to get a baby boy or a baby girl. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. It is Allah who knows. He is the Alimul Ghaib, no one else. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said that whoever believes in what a soothsayer says, he is out of the fold of Islam. In another narration, it goes along the lines that 40 days of your salah will not be accepted. Allahu Akbar. And how do these fortune tellers, so some come up and say, you know what he said came true. What he said came true. So how do they get this knowledge? They have links with the jinnat. They have links with the evil jinnat. These evil jinnat, they go up to the heavens and try to overhear what the malaika are speaking. Okay? And at that time, that is when rujuman lishayateen. The stars are hurled at them to chase them away. To chase them away. So when they go and overhear, say out of 100 things, they may overhear one thing. Something. Okay? And then they come and tell the fortune teller, okay, it may happen like this. So he gives you a big fancy story, a big fairy tale. One sentence of it might come true. One sentence of it might come true. Yesterday, I had a lecture on Dajjal. And in there, I spoke about Ibn Sayyad. Many people are not aware of Ibn Sayyad. Ibn Sayyad was an individual, he was from the Jews of Medina. He was from the Jews of Medina. When Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to Medina, he was a youngster. He was a youngster. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam settled in Medina. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to often mention about Dajjal, about the coming of Dajjal. Allahu Akbar. It is indeed a serious matter. It is indeed a serious matter. One of the signs to indicate the proximity of the coming of Dajjal is that the mention of Dajjal would reduce. Scholars would stop talking about Dajjal. Scholars would not talk about Dajjal on the manabir, on the pulpits, in their sermons. People would forget about Dajjal. People would start interpreting Dajjal as some kind of a symbolic figure. They would start giving him metaphors. They would start giving him figurative expressions. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, Dajjal is not the television set. Dajjal is not the World Wide Web. Dajjal is not the Freemasons. Dajjal is an individual with the specific characteristics that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam described him with. Of course, the Freemasons may be a society that may help Dajjal, but they themselves are not Dajjal. Don't come up to me and say the triangle with the one eye, that is Dajjal, or the American dollar is Dajjal. That is not Dajjal. The hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that beautifully describes Dajjal. He is not beautiful. I'm talking about the hadith. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he describes Dajjal. Listen to the description, I'll give you a summary of it. He will be a person with a ruddy white complexion, with a protruding forehead. He'll have two eyes, both eyes will be defective, one will be blind. One will be mamsukh, and that is why he is known as Al-Masih al-Dajjal. One would be as if it is wiped off, a thick layer of skin will be over it. And the other eye will be like a protruding, floating grape. A grapefruit. Both of his eyes, two eyes. No, don't think of that minion character with one eye on the top. That's not the Dajjal. Okay? Two eyes. He'll have a protruding forehead upon which kafir will be written. So do you have a television set with you which has these descriptions? With kafir written on it and two eyes protruding. Do you have a television set like that? No. His hair will be curly locks, thick locks, which will be like serpents intertangled in one another. He will be short, he will be stout, and he will be powerfully built. He will have a wide and thick neck, like, you know, you have these traps over here. Traps. The guys who go to gym would know. Traps. So when you work out the traps and when you flex, it shows as if you have a wide neck. So he would look like that because he's powerfully built. And he would walk with his feet set apart, once again because he is powerfully built, would walk like this. That's how Dajjal would walk. So all of these clear descriptions have been given by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So how could we interpret this to be a metaphor? How could we interpret this into a figurative expression? No, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, he is an individual who is currently alive in an island where nobody knows, according to the hadith of Tamim al-Dari radiallahu anhu. I don't have the time to go into that. Nevertheless, he is an individual who is alive and will come. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all from his fitna, because according to the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his fitna will be the greatest fitna. Will be the greatest fitna this ummah will ever witness from the creation of Adam alayhi salatu wa salam until the day of Qiyamah. Allahu Akbar. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من عذاب القبر
ومن عذاب النار ومن فتنة المحيا والممات ومن فتنة المسيح الدجال.
This is why we are supposed to recite this dua in the tashahud of every salah. This is why. Because the fitna of Dajjal is so great. All of us have to seek protection from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For it is only through iman and the help of Allah that you will be able to escape from the fitna of Dajjal. He will be such an overcoming character, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. So coming back to Ibn Sayyad, let's quickly, swiftly finish off that story. He was a character, a youngster, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to Medina. And after some time, after he grew up, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself thought that that guy was Dajjal, Ibn Sayyad. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam thought he was Dajjal. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had a doubt as to whether he is Dajjal. Narration, Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, he narrates that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Umar radiallahu anhu, both of them go to check on this character, Ibn Sayyad. His name was Safi. In another narration, Abdullah Ibn Sayyad, his father's name was Sayyad, he was known as Ibn Sayyad. So they go to meet him, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam hits him on his back. He turns and looks. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asks him, the reason being why Rasulullah went to meet him is because he was causing all kinds of mischief and corruption. He was being a fortune teller, soothsayer, telling people about unseen things which were not true. Whilst Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was alive, so Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to him and asked him, Ya Ibn Sayyad, do you believe that I am the final messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Now I told you, he is a character. He's a funny character. So he replied, I believe that you are the messenger of the uneducated. He replied as such. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam again asked him, this hadith is recorded in Muslim. Again he asked him, Ibn Sayyad, do you confirm that I am the messenger of Allah? I believe in Allah and all of his messengers, he replies. He replied. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to check him, it was at that moment, a few moments ago, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam received the revelation of Surah Al-Dukhan. Surah Al-Dukhan. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was concealing it within himself. So he asked Ibn Sayyad, do you know what I am concealing? Yes, I know. You are concealing dukh. You are concealing dukh. So the scholars mention, it is either Ibn Sayyad was trying to play a game with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or that the supernatural forces, these evil jinnat that were helping Ibn Sayyad, that is evident from the story. These jinnat had gone to the heavens and heard part of the story. They had heard part of the story and they came and gave him half of the information. They didn't give him the full name. They didn't give him that it is Dukhan. They came and told him it is Dukh. And that's the reason he said, he thought it is Dukh and he said Dukh. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam immediately pushes him aside and says that this youngster will never ever reach what he is trying to become. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that and he goes on. And then the narration goes on. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on another day, he goes to see what Ibn Sayyad is doing from a distance. He was behind a tree. Because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not receive any wahi regarding Ibn Sayyad. So he wanted to confirm the fact that the jinnat of these evil forces are helping him. Rasulullah was behind a tree, and then at that time, Ibn Sayyad was on his bed with a blanket over him and he was murmuring something, some kind of a mantra. He was murmuring something. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was trying to listen to it, but then the mother of Ibn Sayyad comes from the other corner. She recognizes Rasulullah and she says, Ya Safi, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has come. He jumps out of the bed and throws the blanket away and runs. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then says, if his mother had not come, I would have known the reality of this youngster. I would have told you all the reality of this youngster. Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anhu then goes on to mention that they all left on a hajj, a pilgrimage, hajj or umrah. Whilst they were in the journey, they stopped at a place to camp. And whilst they were camping in that location, the people of that caravan, they went off for their work. And Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anhu was left alone with Ibn Sayyad. Now he was petrified because he had heard all of these stories about Ibn Sayyad. He was so scared of him because many of the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, all of them had a doubt that perhaps he could be Dajjal. Okay? And this incident took place after Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away. Now Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiyallahu anhu's incident. So Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiyallahu anhu, he was petrified because he was alone with Ibn Sayyad. So they came, and now Ibn Sayyad brings a cup of milk to him and asks him to drink it. Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiyallahu anhu, he says, "No, it is hot and the milk is also hot. I don't want it." The only reason being, he did not want to accept anything from Ibn Sayyad. He did not want to accept anything from Ibn Sayyad. So then Ibn Sayyad understood that he is refusing because of this. And Ibn Sayyad said, "You know, Abu Sa'id, I feel like hanging myself. I feel like hanging myself." Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiyallahu anhu then asked him, Why do you feel as such, Ibn Sayyad?" "No, the reason being, everybody is calling me Dajjal. And I don't like this. I don't like this. You, of all people, you are from the Ansar and you know a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam more. Has not the Prophet of Allah described Dajjal to be sterile?" That is one of the descriptions. He will be sterile. He will have no children. And then Ibn Sayyad will say, "You know, I have left my son in Medina and I am traveling. So how can I be Dajjal?" And then he will say, "You know that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that Dajjal will never be able to enter Medina nor Mecca, because Dajjal in reality will not be able to enter Medina or Mecca because angels will be guarding those two cities brandishing swords." Allahu Akbar. So then he says, "Now you saw me, I was in Medina, now I am traveling to Mecca, so how can I be Dajjal?" Then Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anhu, he says in the narration, "I almost accepted his excuses. But then just when I was about to accept his excuses, he says, 'But you know something, Abu Sa'id? I know where Dajjal is and I know who he is. And if I am offered the post of Dajjal, I will readily accept it. I will readily accept it.'" So he was a funny and confusing character where they could not place him. So scholars such as Imam Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani rahimahullah, they say, and the other amazing thing about him is he suddenly vanished away. He suddenly vanished. Nobody knows where he went. So scholars mentioned that one explanation is that he could be linked to the real Dajjal. He could be linked to the real Dajjal and he could be a jinn, the evil qareeb. He could be a jinn. And the other narrations mention, the other aqwal of the scholars, they say that he could be one of the 30 Dajjal. Because Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, before the real Dajjal comes, 30 mini Dajjals will come, mini Dajjals. All of them who will claim false prophethood. And you have all of them, I think around 20 to 28 to 29 of them have come. Musaylamah al-Kadhab, then you have the lady prophet Sajja, then you have Aswad al-Ansi, you have so many characters who, Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, you have so many characters who claim prophethood, who are considered to be from this 30 Dajjal. Nevertheless, why I brought this story is the point Dukh. I had to tell the whole story. Dukh. You see, Rujum al-Shayateen. The jinn goes to the heavens and tries to pick information and gets only partial of the information and comes down. Dukh. So this is why I mentioned the story of Ibn Sayyad. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, now coming back to the creation of Allah the Almighty. You look around you, look at all of the creations. You don't have to even look around you, look at your own self. Look at your own body. Look at your brain, look at the power of your brain. Look at your memory. You take any computer today, whether it be in the terabytes, even there is a limit, it stops. But the memory of man, unlimited. Unlimited. Allahu Akbar. Where is all of these images? Every single day you meet a new human being, you capture an image of his face and his name. And you know him. Someday, 10 years, 20 years later, you meet him, you know you are so and so. If you have a good memory. So where are all of these, where are the databases and where are the servers where all of these images are saved? Allahu Akbar. You look at your heart, pumping every single second. Look at the nerves in your body. Look at this saliva. If not for this saliva, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, your tongue would not move in the way it is moving. Your throat would be dry and parched. Your lips would start to crack. Have you ever visited a patient suffering from cancer in the intensive care? Due to the power of the treatment, he or she is going under the chemotherapy and all of those things, the UV radiation, it dries their whole body. Their mouth generally will be open like a bird. Like a bird. They will be croaking. Tubes will be going through their throat. They will not be able to talk. Why? Because the saliva is missing. Saliva. This is one of the great creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at our sweat, look at our tears.
they taste salty. But as for our saliva, if our saliva was salty, just imagine what would have happened to us. Then look at our blood running all over the body. All of these, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, prove the power and the grandeur of our Creator. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, let me wrap it up with a beautiful piece of poetry, and I hope it serves as food for thought. Just give me a minute or two. It's a beautiful piece of Arabic poetry which talks about the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Arab poet, he says,
لله في الآفاك آيات لعل أقلها هو ما إليه هداك ولعل ما في النفس من آياته عجب عجاب لو ترى عيناك والكون مشحون بأسرار إذا حاولت تفسيرا لها أعيهاك.
For Allah the Almighty, in the horizons are so many signs, so many signs. If only the smallest of it would guide you, if only the smallest sign of Allah the Almighty would guide you.
وَلَعَلَّ مَا فِي النَّفْسِ مِنْ آيَاتِهِ عَجَبٌ عُجَابٌ.
And leave alone the horizons, your own body, look at your own body. A wonder of wonders, Allahu Akbar. لَوْ تَرَى عَيْنَاكَ. Only if your eyes could see this wonder. The whole universe, mashhoonun bi asrar, is full of secrets, full of signs of the great Creator, Allah the Almighty. And if you were to try to interpret those secrets and those signs, you would tire yourself. You would fail, you would tire yourself.
قل للطبيب تخطفته يد الرجا يا شافي الأمراض من أرداك قل للمريض نجا وعوفي بعدما عجزت فنون الطب من عافاك قل للصحيح يموت لا من علة من بالمنايا يا صحيح هداك.
Ask the doctor. Ask the doctor, تَخَطَّفَتْهُ يَدُ الرَّدَى. The doctor who a terminal disease has caught hold of him. Ask this doctor, oh doctor, the one who cures all of these diseases, who is the one who made you fall ill? The doctor who cures everyone's diseases, who is the one who made you fall ill? Ask the patient, where doctors have left their hands, have lost hope on him. They have said that his death line is today and tomorrow. He may die today or tomorrow. Ask that patient who walked out of the hospital healthy, ask him who gave you that cure, who cured you. Ask the person who was fit and able, the one who was healthy, with no disease whatsoever, but he suddenly died. Ask him, who is the one who gave you death whilst you are in the prime of your age, whilst you are in the prime of your youth?
قل للبصير وكان يحذر حفرة فهوايا فهوى بها من ذا الذي أهواك بل سائل الأعمى خطى بين الزحام بلا اصطدام من يقود خطاك.
As the one who has good eyesight, who has good eyesight and he is walking on the street, he is avoiding potholes, he does not want to fall into a pit, but then he fell into a pit. Ask him, who made you fall into this pit? And then ask the one who is blind, who has no eyesight whatsoever, but he is crossing a street with heavy traffic and he does not face an accident. Ask him, who guided you from point A to point B? Ask him, who gave you the sight to cross from point A to point B? And then he goes on to say,
قل للجنين يعيش معزولا بلا راع ومرعى ما الذي يرعاك.
Ask the fetus in the stomach. Ask that child which has not been born, the fetus in the stomach, who is the one who is looking after you? Who is the one who is giving you food? Who is looking after you until you come to this world?
قل للوليد بكى وأجهش بالبكاء لدى الولادة ما الذي أبكاك.
Ask the child, the newborn child,
who comes out into this world and starts crying and sobbing. Ask the child, who made you cry, O child? وَإِذَا تَرَى الثُّعْبَانَ يَنْفُثُ سُمَّهُ فَاسْأَلْهُ مَنْ ذَا بِالسُّمُومِ حَشَاكَ. Ask the snake, ask that vicious serpent, when it spits out its poison, ask that serpent, who is the one who created you filled with such venom, filled with such poison? وَاسْأَلْهُ كَيْفَ تَعِيشُ يَا ثُعْبَانُ أَوْ تَحْيَا وَهَذَا السُّمُّ يَمْلَأُ فَاكَ. And ask this serpent once again, how are you living? How are you living with all of this poison filling your mouth? Ask this serpent, how are you living with all of this poison filling your mouth? وَاسْأَلْ بُطُونَ النَّحْلِ كَيْفَ تَقَاطَرَتْ شَهْدًا. Ask the bees, ask the bellies of the bees, how they produce those sweet drops of honey. وَكُلِّ شَهْدِ مَنْ حَلَّاكَ. And then ask the drops of honey, who made you so sweet, O honey? Who made you so sweet? بَلْ سَائِلِ اللَّبَنَ الْمُصَفَّى كَانَ بَيْنَ دَمٍ وَفَرْثِ مَنِ الَّذِي صَفَّاكَ. Ask the pure white milk. Ask the pure white milk that comes from between blood and stool. Who made you so pure, so sweet, and so white? Ask that milk. وَإِذَا رَأَيْتَ النَّبْتَ فِي الصَّحْرَاءِ يَرْبُو وَحْدَهُ فَاسْأَلْهُ مَنْ أَرْبَاكَ. Ask that cactus which grows in the middle of the desert all alone. O cactus, who makes you grow all alone in this desert? وَإِذَا رَأَيْتَ الْبَدْرَ يَسْرِي نَاشِرًا أَنْوَارُهُ فَاسْأَلْهُ مَنْ أَسْرَاكَ. Ask the full moon. On a beautiful night, ask that full moon, who makes you come like this in different stages and spread your light? Who is the one who created you? وَاسْأَلْ شُعَاءَ الشَّمْسِ يَدْنُو وَهِيَ أَبْعَدُ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ مَا الَّذِي أَدْنَاكَ. Ask the rays of sunlight, the beautiful rays of sunlight that reach us. Who is the one who created the source of your sunlight so far away? Who created the sun so far away but made the rays of sunlight come so close to us? وَإِذَا رَأَيْتَ النَّخْلَ مَشْقُوقًا نَوَى فَاسْأَلْهُ مَنْ يَا نَخْلُ شَقَّ نَوَاكَ. Ask the date palm. Ask the date palm that broke off from one tiny kernel, from one tiny seed. Who made you break and sprout out from that seed, from that tiny kernel? وَإِذَا رَأَيْتَ النَّارَ شَبَّ لَهِيبُهَا فَاسْأَلْ لَهِيبَ النَّارِ مَنْ أَوْرَاكَ. And when you see the fire eating away at the firewood, when you see the fire eating away at the firewood, ask the firewood, who set you ablaze? Who made you burn like this? وَإِذَا تَرَى صَخْرًا تَفْجُرُ بِالْمِيَاهِ فَسَأَلْهُ مَنْ بِالْمَاءِ شَقَّ صَفَاكَ. When you see a waterfall far away, ask the rocks between the waterfall, who split you so that water can come gushing out from you? And like this, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, he goes on mentioning sign after sign, creation after creation of the Almighty, of our beloved Maker. And finally he says, يَا أَيُّهَا الْإِنسَانِ يَا أَيُّهَا الْإِنسَانُ مَهْلَا مَنْ لَذِي بِاللَّهِ جَلَّ جَلَالُهُ أَغْرَاكَ. O mankind, you are taking it slow. You are not following me. Haven't these great creations of the Almighty made you wonder in utter amazement? Allahu Akbar. So many mentions, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. All of these creations of Allah the Almighty should make us ponder and reflect on Him. Sadly, we see today people who are proclaiming atheism, saying there is no God.